Hey, my name's Rick. I'm an alcoholic.
Bob, alcoholic.
Okay, I guess we're going to move on out of these resentment inventory into the fear inventory.
You guys can, is that I was okay? Afraid of that.
It scare you a little bit? Okay, so we're gonna start on the bottom of page 67, right after that fourth column, or the paragraph that pertains to the fourth column.
Notice that the word fear is bracketed alongside the difficulties with Mr. Brown, Mrs. Jones, the employer, and the wife.
They're talking about on page 65, in the third column, the affects my column, fear is bracketed alongside of all those difficulties, because fear is what's motivating the anger. You can't be angry without being fearful. You can be fearful without being angry, but anger is fear. And you'll start to see a direct relationship between the two. But that's why there's a separate fear inventory, so we can deal with the stuff where you don't have resentments in connection with them. But you might find some as you start to write your fears out. We'll give you a sheet in a little bit on that particular inventory, but I don't want to hand them out right now until after we've read through it. Otherwise, guys are reading sheets instead of looking at the book, you know.
So, fear. This short word somehow touches about every aspect of our lives. It was an evil and corroding thread. The fabric of our existence was shot through with it. It set in motion trains of circumstances which brought us misfortune we felt we didn't deserve. But did not we ourselves set the ball rolling? Sometimes we think fear ought to be classed with stealing. It seems to cause more trouble.
Now here's some of those sentences again that I kind of used to slide past. I didn't understand them very well, so I wouldn't look very deeply at it. But let's think about this a minute. He says, fear is an evil and corroding thread. The fabric of my existence is shot through with it. So it, fear, set in motion trains of circumstances which brought me misfortune I felt I didn't deserve. So what does that look like? I'll give you an example of how that looks from my life, because I think it's important to talk from examples. It's just easier to understand this stuff. Pam and I were together for 11 years. When we first met, now this is really a great looking gal. I mean, she was, when she'd drink, she'd get real out there. She'd be talking to everybody and stuff like that. And she had a body on her that was, made me nervous around other guys. You know what I mean? So we're out at the bar. Standing, I'll never forget this. We're standing at the bar. She's on the end or near the end and I'm next to her. In from the end, and there's some guy comes over and starts talking to her. Yes, and he's a big guy, so it's not like I'm just going to start bullying him around, okay? And he's a good-looking guy, and they're getting along.
Oh, shit.
Yep. Isn't that a rough one, huh? So the insecurity starts because she gets along with him. And now I feel insecure because I got trouble with her. You know, we've been going out, but there's these grievances and stuff going, you know. You know how it is. So this guy goes off to the restroom. So I start slamming him to her, you see. That's the way I'm going to deal with this. I'm going to hassle her about talking. You shouldn't talk. I mean, this is just insanity, but it's what I did, okay? So I'm hassling her now. He comes back and we just leave right away. I get her out of there. I don't want to do this anymore. So then we have one of those meaningful conversations on the way home. You know what I mean? You know, one of those that starts at 9 o'clock and by 2 a.m. it's worse than when you started. You ever had one of those?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Figured you might have.
Foreplay.
Yeah. Exactly. I don't like this. And now I got trouble with her because of this. And I don't like this kind of a thing, and it happens all the time with her. So I just don't even want to take her out to those places anymore, you know? So I'll just keep her at home. I won't take her to those places. But you know what the problem is? She goes out with her girlfriends out to those places. See? And then I'm sitting there waiting for her to come home sometimes. And I don't know what's going on or what she's doing. I know what she does when I'm there. What does she do when I'm not? Ah, you know what I mean, guys? And then she comes home and you hassle her and push at her and cause all kinds of problems with her. My fear was setting in motion trains of circumstances which brought me misfortune I felt I didn't deserve. The more you hassle her, the more she pulls away. The more you try and control the circumstances, the more she pulls away. It actually had the exact opposite effect of what I wanted to happen. And my fear of losing her was bringing about the very thing I didn't want, the destruction of the relationship. Isn't it strange how my fears actually bring about what I don't want to happen? You notice that? So this stuff is very destructive and damaging for me. And if I don't deal with this stuff and take a look at it, see, I wanted her to be my security because I was insecure. And you know what? The more you try and do that with someone, what are you doing? You're taking from the relationship. And you know what happens when you take? You become more insecure. You don't feel secure by controlling it. Actually, the more you try and take, the more insecure you feel. Which in this case makes you want to control more, and you actually bring about the destruction of the relationship. So my fear was setting in motion trains of circumstances which brought me misfortune I felt I didn't deserve, but did not I set the ball rolling? See how that is? It's pretty interesting when you start seeing this. In business stuff, this happens all the time. You know, maybe you're working at a company and a new guy comes on. Maybe you've been there a long time. Maybe you're a dinosaur. You've been there for 20 years or something, and maybe you think they want to get rid of you or something, and some new guy comes in, some little upstart comes out of college or something, and he's bright and people like him, and you feel threatened. So you slam him a little bit here and there in the office, you know, try and get people to dislike him and things like that, and he's not doing anything in particular. I'm just insecure, see? And you actually bring about what you don't want. They fire you. They get rid of you because you're a problem in the office then. Or you're a problem on the job sites if you're in the trades because of your fear of whatever. This is astonishing when you start to look at the ramifications of this stuff. It will actually bring about what I don't want to happen. You following me on this? Wow. I had no awareness of any of this. I didn't even know I was fearful when I came into AA. I knew I was angry, but I didn't know I was fearful. When I started, you know, guys are trained different than, we're conditioned different in society than women are. Women are much more tuned into this stuff than guys are. They're much more willing to look at it and admit to it. But you know, this macho crap, you know, I'm not afraid, and you know, put on this airs, put on these pretenses and pretend and whatever. But the truth of the matter was, I was showing it all the time in my relationship with women. And you think you can control it. But you know what? All I did was destroy the relationships with my fears. Sad.
I had a client I mentioned earlier that all of my hateful rage was directed against colleagues and other musicians and stuff like that. I had a client, I wrote advertising music for years, and I had a client who was a very, very regular client. He almost always hired me, virtually all the time. He would hire me to do music. And he was a good friend and still is a good friend. And one time, some years ago, I heard that he had hired somebody else to do some music for one of his clients. Some guy in San Diego. I don't know the guy. I hated the guy. I didn't know his name. I would have put a contract on him if I could have found out his name. Some guy in San Diego. I get rageful. I get on the phone. I start calling people, blasting this guy in San Diego. I don't know who it is. I've never met him. Telling everybody how bad he is. Don't hire him. He costs way too much. He does terrible work. Stay away from this guy in San Diego. I'm just rageful. Well, my client, whose name is Joe, was a good enough friend that he called me up. And he said, what in the world are you doing? That wasn't his language, but he said, what in the world are you doing? And he said, you know, I understand. He said, you feel like you're going to lose my business. You're not going to lose my business. They wanted to try somebody else once. It's not a regular deal. You're my guy. But he said, I'll tell you, if you keep doing what you're doing, I will not ever hire you again. So I'm hearing about this behavior. People are calling me, telling me stuff that you're talking about. If you keep doing this, we're done. So I got caught at it big time.
This goes on in male-female stuff all the time. Mm-hmm. People trying to control it. You know, you get sober and you got trouble with your family and you can't leave it alone. You just want to keep pushing at her because you want to get her back. You're afraid somebody else is going to come along or whatever it is, you know. And you actually bring about the very thing you don't want. So we're going to look at an inventory on fear. So at the top of page 68, they've listed out some questions for us to look at our fears. So
we reviewed our fears thoroughly. We put them on paper even though we had no resentment in connection with them.
So I might find some resentments in connection with my fears if I put them on paper. I might start to see that I'm angry about this or whatever, okay? So it's a good way if you have trouble finding resentment, which has not been my issue, but some guys have trouble seeing their anger, well, you'll find it in your fear inventory often.
So we asked ourselves why we had them.
So we're going to review our fears thoroughly and put them on paper, right? So how would I do that? How about, you know, and a lot of guys will do this. They'll say, well, let's write down you're afraid of spiders, right? Okay, so they'll try and get you to look at it. I'm afraid of judges. I'm afraid of bullies. I'm afraid of the police. I'm afraid of women. I'm afraid of men. I'm afraid of whatever, okay? Now your fear is outside of you, isn't it? Now all your fear is out there. And if you look at it long enough, if you examine it, I suppose it could bring you back to yourself. But, you know, the way to shortcut this whole thing, if you want to review your fears thoroughly and take responsibility for them, is look at it this way. What am I afraid of losing? What am I afraid of losing? Now the fear is not out there, it's in me. I'm afraid of losing something. I'm afraid of losing Pam. I'm afraid of losing my job. I'm afraid of losing my money. I'm afraid of losing my house. I'm afraid of on and on and on. My job, my business, whatever it is. What am I afraid of losing? And we put on the sheets, just for the sake of helping to understand it a little better, we put, what am I afraid of not getting? Why, I'm afraid of not getting my family back. I'm afraid of not getting my money back. I'm afraid of not getting my job back. You know, when you get sober, when you're new. What am I afraid of losing, or what am I afraid of not getting? You know, if you write that down, you will have reviewed your fears thoroughly. Now, let's say that there's a bully out there that you're afraid. And it looks like, well, he's my fear because he's a symbol of my fear. He's going to beat me up. So what am I really afraid of? I'm afraid of what? Losing my health, right? I'm afraid of being beaten up and, you know, whatever. Or being embarrassed. Somebody might see that or, you know, I'd be embarrassed if I found out I yeah. See, on and on and on. That's what we're going to look at. So I think the idea here is to get some awareness of what's going on inside of me so I can quit projecting the fear out there. You can't do anything about something if it's out there. But if I can start to take responsibility for this stuff, then I can see the fears in me. I can do something about me, but if it's out there, I can't do anything about it. And I think you can really shortcut this if you just write your fears down that way. Then you'll start to get some perspective on what's really going on instead of blaming everybody else for it.
We asked ourselves why we had them.
Yeah, why do I have this fear? What's the worst that could happen if it came true? I mean, why do I have this fear? In a sense, in the book, it's sort of a rhetorical question, I think, because it really is a lead-in. But since it was listed, we put it on the sheet that way. Why do I have this fear? Since it's listed that way, but ultimately...
Wasn't it because self-reliance failed us?
Is that why I have this fear? Because I'm reliant on myself?
Self-reliance was good as far as it went, but it didn't go far enough. Some of us once had great self-confidence, but it didn't fully solve the fear problem or any other. When it made us cocky, it was worse.
So is it because I'm reliant on myself that I'm fearful? I mean, think about that. Isn't that reasonable? If I'm reliant on myself, I got every right to be fearful. Well, right? Isn't that true? I mean, what can you possibly predict or know? I might get in a plane crash on the way home. I don't know that. I might get hit driving back to the airport. I can't see the big picture. So I try and determine everything based on what I can see. It's a very limited perspective. You know, it's like looking at the world through a straw. You know, you're looking out on a little point on that wall. I know there's a lot going on around me that I can't see because of my perspective. Now I'm going to determine everything and how to deal with life based on what I can see. Wow, that's a pretty limited perspective, isn't it? Got every right to be fearful. See, this is the thing. This is the thing.
Huh? Perhaps there is a better way.
Boy, I'll tell you. But you know, I'll tell you something, guys. Self-reliance was good as far as it went, right? But it didn't go far enough. So they're not saying you should have no self-reliance. You got to get up and put your shoes and socks on to go out to work. Maybe pants would be good too. You know. So I mean, you have to do certain things for yourself. But ultimately, self-reliance is good as far as it went, but it didn't go far enough. Some of us once had great self-confidence. Oh, yeah. But it didn't fully solve the fear problem or any other. When it made us cocky, it was worse. You know, most guys, I think that when the ego manifests in our lives in arrogance like this, you know, you look at a guy who's grandiose, for example. We think of a guy who's grandiose. He thinks he's better than other people. That's not true. It's not true. Even though he's putting on these pretenses, it's not true. You know what it is? He thinks he's less than, and you're seeing his overcompensation for his fear. You're actually seeing him overcompensate, and he doesn't even know he's doing it. He's just doing it, and it looks silly. I'll give you an example. We got a guy in our meeting. He's probably about 5'9". He's not a big guy. He's narrow built. He's been lifting weights because he was very fearful. He was trying to build himself up so he could control and handle circumstances. He's scared to death all his life. He comes into AA, and he's just freaked out all the time. You can just see it in him. But he's putting on these airs, like he's so tough and everything. You know, he's walking around. He used to come into the doorway. Now, this is just, it's a pretty good-sized meeting room doorway. It's probably 36 inches wide. He'd walk in the door, and he'd duck, and he'd turn. Now you look at this and you think, oh, for Christ's sakes, you know, what is that? You know, what? Thinks he's big. He's like a wiener dog, you know, they think they're tough. You know, it's just. But this is what he'd do, see? And then you look at that and you react to the cockiness. And you, I mean, you know, if you're, it's just crazy, see? It's just crazy. Most people think that the ego manifests in the positive, but it really manifests in the negative. And then you overcompensate for the fears, see? And when you see a guy acting that way, whether he thinks he's smarter than everybody else or better looking or bigger build or whatever it is, people laugh at that. And then they're reacting to his arrogance, when it made us cocky, it was worse. You know, it reminds me of when I was a kid. When I was a kid, the movies were Westerns, right? They were always Westerns. And generally, the story went something like this. There's the guy who's the fastest draw in town. He's standing at the bar, and he's been shooting people up and killing people, and he's fast at drawing a gun. And he thinks that people respect him, but they don't. They're just afraid of him. It's not respect. It's just fear is what it is. He's got great self-confidence at drawing a gun. But then the story, it always went the same way. He'd hear the story, Ringo's coming, right? You know, he's in another town and Ringo's coming, see? And of course, he doesn't know if he can beat Ringo because he has a reputation. So he's standing at the bar waiting for Ringo to come and he's looking around and waiting and drinking. And of course Ringo comes and then blows his butt off or something, you know, just the way the story was. But he had great self-confidence, but it didn't fully solve the fear problem or any other. And then it makes him cocky and everybody's reacting to his cockiness. This is the kind of stuff that goes on all the time in people, and they're not aware of it. See, at least what you're aware of, you have a chance of controlling. But what I'm not aware of is controlling me. Do I want to be a puppet to this stuff, or do I want to find out what's going on? I can't live like that, guys, anymore. I can't live like that with women. I stopped putting my demands on women that they satisfy me or that they fulfill my insecurities. If I'm not okay with myself, she's not going to be able to fulfill my insecurities. And you'll end up hating her because you got an expectation. It's awful. Well, that's what I started to see as I started to write this. So they're just asking us to put this stuff on paper and look at it, you know. Write it down. Find out. Get some awareness of what's going on. And take a look at this cockiness and this arrogance, these putting on errors, pretense, pretending to be something I'm not. You know, when I was a kid, there was a show. There was a cartoon. And it was on Rocky and Bullwinkle, I think, was the show, you know. Or it came on after it or something. And it was about a turtle named Tudor Turtle. You remember Tudor Turtle, was he? He was kind of a dumb kind of talking turtle, and he never wanted to be a turtle. He always wanted to be a big shot.
Mr. Wizard.
Yeah. So Tudor Turtle doesn't want to be a turtle. He wants to be a big shot. So he goes to Mr. Wizard, and he says, Mr. Wizard, can you make me a general in the army? And Mr. Wizard says, oh, I don't think that's a good idea, Tudor. You're going to get in trouble. You know, he is. Oh, no, I really want to be a general in an army. Well, Mr. Wizard knows he's going to get in trouble, so he says, okay. So he puts him out there into the experience. Now, this is analogous to me being a big shot. I want to be a big shot. I don't want to be a regular guy. I got to be a big shot. So Tudor goes out to be a general, and the cartoon was always the same in different forms. The army starts to mass. He's way over his head. He doesn't know what the heck he's doing, see? So he starts to get in trouble. The army's out there. It's just about to crush his little shell, and he'd stop right before he was going to get killed, and he'd say, help, Mr. Wizard, help. And then you'd see a spiral on the TV, and you'd hear Mr. Wizard's voice, and he'd say, Trissel, Trazzle, Truzzle, Trone, time for this one to come home. And then he'd pull Tudor Turtle out of the problem. That's really the seventh step for me, but that's the problem with being a big shot. Big shots always get beat, you know? You got to get beat. You don't want to be a normal guy. Got to be a big shot. Oh, Jesus. You know, and we do this around AA. And I got to tell you something. I'll tell you something that keeps me in line when I start thinking I'm really something. And I don't do this much because I've trained myself away from that kind of thinking as best I can. But whenever I start thinking, you know, you're really a big shot, you know, you get involved in the service structure and you start thinking you're really something, you know, maybe you're a DCM or you're going to be a delegate to New York and you start thinking you're special. You might want to think of it this way. I do. The highest you can become in Alcoholics Anonymous is the elite of the mentally ill. No, that's really something to strive for, isn't it? They warned against big shotism in the early fellowship. You read the history. These guys were doctors, lawyers, stockbrokers, whatever, CEOs of companies and things. The big shot stuff was killing them, man. This was, and you know, since AA's been assimilated into the culture, we don't think much about that. We don't talk much about it anymore. But I got to tell you, I was every bit as susceptible to that crap as anybody was. And it wasn't that I was a big shot. I just thought I was a big shot. And you know, it doesn't really matter either way. You'll be fearful. You'll be fearful. You know, it's like blowing up a balloon. The bigger the balloon gets, the thinner the sides get, right? And you start blowing yourself all up and you know you're a phony. And you're just waiting for somebody to come along and poke it and expose you for the fraud because you know you're a fraud. That's fearful. That's a fearful place to find yourself, and many of us have done that, including myself, at different times. I got to tell you, I can't live like that anymore. I really, that is just too much for me. So?
Perhaps there is a better way. We think so. For we are now on a different basis, the basis of trusting and relying upon God. We trust infinite God rather than our finite selves. We are in the world to play the role he assigns. Just to the extent that we do as we think he would have us and humbly rely on him, does he enable us to match calamity with serenity.
That's right. But I can't do this dependent on myself. The more I have been dependent on Rick, and I come from an atheist perspective originally. I'm not anymore, but I was, okay? When you're an atheist, when good things happen, you take the credit. When bad things happen, you give it to everybody else. I'm constantly controlling everything because I don't believe there's anything else. And if I don't do it, that's one of the reasons I think it was so difficult for me to get to a bottom. I could not admit I couldn't solve my problems. Because if I admit I can't solve them, who's gonna then? And that was really devastating to me when I was crushed by my inability to deal with any problem that I had. And that's really what got me sober. I could not solve my problems. Wow, is that a bad scene when you don't believe in God? Because it's an admission of insanity. And then what? Wow, that was tough. I got to tell you, that was really a tough spot. So how do you match calamity with serenity? What are we talking about here? Well, you got a great example of this.
Yeah, I'll try not to take too long. But
don't worry, you got time.
I was working with a partner who was probably about 20 years younger than I am. And he was going to move to Los Angeles. We were working in Minneapolis. He was going to move to L.A., which he did and is very successful there. And I was going to move, and I thought, I've done everything in the music business that I ever wanted to do. There was one thing that I had never done, and that was write a music score for a feature movie. Done everything else I ever wanted. So David's going to move to L.A. I'm going to go with him. I realize that breaking into the business on that level, by the time I get anywhere, I'm going to be 98 years old, and I might as well just forget the whole thing. So I decided I'll be okay with not doing a feature film. I've done everything else I ever wanted to do. So I decided to stay in Minneapolis. Within about 2 weeks, I get a call from a director who's been shooting a movie up in Alaska, and he lives in Minnesota, and he wants to find somebody local to write the music score because he's been traveling for 2 years and he wants to spend some time at home. So he asked the post-production guy that happens to be a friend of mine, is there anybody around here who can write music for my movie? Well, yeah, as a matter of fact. So Den hooks the two of us up together. So now I've got a feature film to write. So I'm writing, we're recording, we're doing all the stuff. My son Joe was the person who got me into Alcoholics Anonymous in the first place. I followed, after being a dry drunk for 23 years, I followed Joe into the program. In the middle of all this, some things came up in Joe's life that he couldn't deal with. He went on a binge. And as I'm working on this movie, Joe commits suicide. Joe kills himself. I really don't have very much memory of this. I can think about it from other people's comments. But we finished the movie, we went to L.A., we did all the parties and all the stuff that you're going to do. And people said to me, Bob, how could you do that? How could you do that work with that kind of tragedy? What courage you have. You know what? I know one thing for sure. I didn't do it. This had to be God helping me do this because I didn't do it. And as I say, I don't have a lot of memory of it. I just know that we finished, we got it done. And here we are. God enabled me to match calamity with serenity. That's the only answer I can come up with for this. And it was that kind of feeling. And I have we put a dedication to my son's memory on the credits of the movie. And that's really the only memory that I have of that.
What was the movie?
It's called Running Free. I don't know if you can still get it on Blockbuster, I think. It had a nice television run. It was on Cinemax and HBO and Stars. But this is some years ago now. This is almost 20 years ago. That was the first feature that I did. And I've done a few more since then, but that was the first one. But matching calamity with serenity. When I read that sentence in the book, I was like, oh, my God. Because I'm sure that's exactly what happened. We never apologize. See what I have to put up with. I am truly clueless. I am so grateful for I've been clueless my whole life, and I am so grateful. Yeah. Because I don't, you know, I in the music business, I went through some times in my life where I did do the big shot thing. I played big shot. Rick used to kid me, like, I got to the top of the ladder and then discovered it was against the wrong wall.
He did. He did.
Yeah. We never apologize to anyone for depending upon our Creator. We can laugh at those who think spirituality is the way of weakness. Paradoxically, it is the way of strength. The verdict of the ages is that faith means courage. All men of faith have courage. They trust their God. We never apologize for God. Instead, we let Him demonstrate through us what He can do.
You see what that is? You know, when I was reading this stuff, and as I started to come to believe, and I was studying a lot of spiritual teachers and things like that, you know, I was trying to grasp. I was reading the mystics, okay? One of the things you'll find if you read the mystical literature, whether it be Hindu, Buddhist, Christian, they're all saying the same thing. Once you get to the true teaching of it, you'll see they're all saying the same thing. Well, I'm doing a lot of that searching because I'm trying to figure things out, and I'm, you know, doing the best I can. But I remember reading some things in the New Testament about that guy Jesus, for example, you know. And and always when he would heal someone, somebody seemed like they'd come up and say, "How'd you do that?" Well, he didn't say, "Well, I adjusted them here and I adjusted them there," and then he didn't say anything like that. He always says, "I didn't do it, the Father did the works." He does this over and over and over. And I often wondered what the heck that was about, see? He knew it was through him, not of him. Every major spiritual teacher has that idea. They all do. They all say the same thing. They don't take the credit, or you start building a big ego about it, and that's the opposite of spirituality, see? It's just absurd. So we never apologize for God. Instead, we let Him, God, demonstrate through us what He can do. Not what I can do, what He can do. See? And I got to tell you, I've had to step back, you know, from thinking you're doing it. Especially with inventory with guys and that sort of thing. Start taking credit for people's sobriety. Oh, I feel pretty good. You know, I got 460 sponsees. You know? I mean, it's just crazy, you know? You know, and I don't have that. It's just, I'm just using that as a stupid example, you know? But you understand what I'm saying? You know, you start feeling pretty good about guys who are staying sober. What, are you going to take the credit when they get drunk, too? Oh, no, I don't want that. You know? Well, guess what? You will take that credit, too, because you'll never get out from the weight of that mind, of that judgment, in a sense. It's the same thing we've been talking about all through this. You had an experience of that, didn't you?
Well, I sponsored a kid, and I did everything that you could possibly do wrong. I didn't know what I was doing, but I was early in the program. And he went out and got drunk, and I felt terrible. I was telling a friend of mine that I sponsored this kid, and he went out and got drunk. And my friend said, you know, one of these days you're going to sponsor somebody that will succeed in staying sober, then you're going to want the credit. Sure.
Same thing?
Same thing. You seeing the common thread through this whole inventory so far? That I'm looking out here for problems and the problems are in here? This is through the fear inventory, through the resentment inventory?
Or solutions.
Yeah.
Looking for solutions
right
out here and the solutions in here.
Exactly.
It's the same thing.
Exactly. When the man says, nobody can make me drink, nobody can make me get sober. It's my choice. It's up to me. I can be angry and resentful and fearful. I can be peaceful and trust God. It's up to me. We ask Him to remove our fear and direct our attention to what He would have us be. At once we commence to outgrow fear.
So this was their experience, that's all. They wrote down their experience of how this all worked for them. I would suggest, if you haven't done this, just to write it. out and get some perspective on what's going on so you can stop blaming others for your fears and take responsibility for what's going on. Because you can't do anything about it if somebody else is doing it. But at least I can make changes once I see things. But if I don't see it, it's going to control me. And that's the thing I think about a lot, you know. Stick your head in the sand isn't going to help at this point. I've got to become aware. Awareness is the key to this whole thing. And I think that's what this fear inventory is really about, is to get some perspective.